So, given this, now we need to understand. Let us even talk about how did this divinity manifest itself like this? What are the building blocks? Is there a way to understand? Yes, we can very systematically understand that also, that there are some beautiful building blocks by which this whole notion of Sarvam Vishnumayam Jagat actually happens. So let's try to understand some of those. And there are some very important guiding principles for that. The first thing that we need to understand is divinity is simply an expression of infinity. Is the first principle. And if you ask me what is infinity, somebody asked me, one young girl asked me, what is infinity? So how do you tell a 3 year, 5 year old girl what is infinity? You cannot say mathematical concepts and so on. The idea is, I give a simple answer. Anything which is nature is infinity. So you have to explain that again to the girl. I said, I asked her, go to the front of the house, put some water and then wet the 10 by 10 square feet front part of the house. People every day put rangoli. Before that they little bit sweep the house and then put some water, right? Now, if you want to do that for the whole city of Bangalore, or you want to do it for the whole of South India at the same time, I don't think science can ever find a machine which can do it. Find science can never actually find a machine. We have a machine called rain. That's what a rain does. It drizzles all over the city. In no time, you are able to wet every speck, not even a speck of dust is left. That's called expression of infinity. I'll give you one more expression of infinity for those who are engineers who love engineering. You take a house, a room, okay? You want to air condition it. Bring it, the temperature is 27 degrees, you want to bring it 24 degrees. People will immediately calculate the cubic volume of this room, then they'll calculate how many tonnage of AC you have to put. They'll tell you, sir, if you put a 1 ton AC in 10, 15, 20 minutes, this temperature will come down from 27 to 24. Now, please tell me, this is a closed system. By the way, you have to close the door. To keep it open, it is not going to happen. Now, I want to ask you, I want to bring down the temperature of city of Bangalore from 27 to 24 in 2 minutes. Can you do it? Yes. That is called a rain-bearing cloud and a wind, or maybe even a rain, 5 minute drizzle. We bring down the temperature in an open system, not a closed system. In an open system, you can bring down the temperature in 3 minutes. Science cannot find a machine, whatever they do. Impossible to find a machine. Thermodynamics says you cannot cool down an open place with this kind of a vast open space. So please understand, whenever you see natural forces, understand divinity is in front of you. Divinity, that's the first principle of divinity. Then, multiple manifestations can come out of a common source. This is how the law of conservation divinity starts expressing. So many manifestations can come out of a common source. For example, with gold, you can make a whole world of ornaments. Everything is made of gold. With a place called space, there is a place, there is a simple concept or entity called space. You do something to it, it becomes a bedroom. You do something to it, it becomes a bathroom. You structure it in another way, it becomes a living room, or it becomes a kitchen. It is all space, by the way. You collapse everything, it will become space. So, it is possible that multiple manifestations can come out of a common source. So, this is where it starts, the process, and that source is infinite. That is the expression of divinity. Third rule, all manifestations can come out of a single source. You don't need multiple sources. From a single source, you can bring anything. All the world of wood or the world of gold can come out of gold. The world of stone architecture and so all kinds of things happening out of stone will come out of stone. So, there can be a common source, and from that common source, which can be a single source, you can create a world of possibilities, is what these limited examples are telling. That is what actually law of conservation of divinity is at action. That's what it is trying to do. The cause can exist independent of the effect. The gold is the cause. The necklace is the effect. Mud is the cause. Pot or a teacup is the effect. Now, a mud teacup cannot have an independent existence out without mud. You cannot, when you, moment you say a plastic cup, that cup cannot have an independent existence without plastic. Plastic gave it that thing. Moment you say a golden necklace, the necklace cannot have an independent existence without gold. But the reverse can happen. You can melt all the necklace, it will become gold. You can melt all plastic, it will become a cup and this and that, and it will become. You can break the teacup, you can break a mud pot, you can break some nice ornamental mud, idol, break everything, put it into water, all of them become mud again. That's what we are saying. In other words, divinity can exist independent, and whereas it can create a lot of varieties, but still it can be independent. That's the point. The God stays alone, aloof, but out of God you can create anything. That's what the law of conservation of divinity is telling us, and that's what is actually happening in our thing. Now, if you say, if there is a single source, out of single source you create a whole lot of things, I will get very confused what is what. So the last rule of law of conservation of divinity is there must be a method to uniquely obtain many from the one. So for which there is an equation with five components. There is a sat, there is a chit, then there is a guna, there is a nama, and there is a rupa. That is equal to the world of multiplicity. We will take an example. Okay. You take water. The water can be called water. Water can be called ice. Water can be called steam. Water can be called wave. Water can be called foam. All these are water. So how do you arrive at all these? You will use this formula. Each one of them have a name, a rupa and a guna, and they basically come from a sit, sat and a chit. So this is how the divinity created the whole world. You know, in Taittiriya Upanishad, all these are very nicely done in Upanishads in many ways. You have to understand it with sukshma. In Taittiriya Upanishad, in Brahmanandavalli, there is this nice concepts are all in a very good form it comes. It says, Sokamayata, the divinity one day desired. Saha akamayata, Sokamayata, Bahusyam prajayeti, let me create this world. I am feeling alone. I am feeling bored. Bahusyam prajayeti, Satapo tapyata, satapas tapto. What is this tapas? Tapas is the know-how. See, if you want to make this, this mouse, which I am showing you, if you want to make this mouse, there is some amount of thinking which went behind it. Such a small little piece. R&D, some engineers worked on it, some plastic, some silicon and all kinds of people. If you have to create this world, you need mahatapas. You have to articulate this process. So kamayata bahusyam prajayeti satapo tapyata satapas taptva. He got this whole know-how. Idagam sarvam asrijata. He created this whole world. Taittiriya Upanishad says that. You look at every Purana. Purana has pancha lakshanas. One of the lakshana is you should talk about samsarga. You should talk about origin of the universe. So in every Purana it is explained. Bhagavata Purana, book 3, Tritiya Skandam is completely the creation process. Beautiful. They have different ways they have articulated. It's a very complex concept. You have to very figuratively explain it. There is one sarga in Aranyakanda in Ramayana, 23rd sarga, 20 something like that, in the 20s. Rama meets Jatayu, and Jatayu asked, "Who are you?" Rama said, "I am Dasharatha's son," and so on. Rama asked, "Who are you?" In 22 shlokas, the complete creation process is so beautifully explained there in Aranyakanda. In Mahabharata, in Adi Parva, which is the first Parva, look at the 66th Sarga. It's a vivid description of how this world was created. I mean, it's a very complex process, but instead of this black hole and all that, there is, if you read it, I think maybe there is some possibility. It looks a little, you know, at one level it may look like a fantasy, but at another level you begin to think maybe these are all things that ought to have happened. So all our Puranas talk about it, Itihasas talk about it, all these are part of that. So I'm only bringing those ideas in a different way here. So therefore, this whole law of conservation of divinity is actually in the eye of the beholder. It is already there. Don't think divinity means, as we see in one of these movies or these serials that they show, you know, some of these God serials and so on, or the Vittalacharya movie. Moment you say divinity, you know, some bright spot, some smoke will come, some cloud, something will happen. Then there is a ray of light, bright light, some chakra will rotate, or it will break open, and then Mahavishnu will come with all his Sangha Chakra Gada and all. Divinity is not like that. I mean, they want to, because, you know, it needs to be articulated in a particular way, they are doing all that. Divinity is not outside. If you think Vishnu is going to come in front of you like that, you are actually wasting your time. You will be hugely disappointed. Vishnu may come like a cow, can come like an ant, can come like a cockroach, which you are madly after killing, can come like a mosquito also. So this divinity is not outside. It is in the eye of the beholder. I will give you an example so that you understand this well. Let's take chemistry. Let's say I am very fond of organic chemistry. So I understand, for me, the world is methane and benzene and phenol and aldehydes and ketones and all kinds of complex organic chemistry. But, you know, if I keep on traveling in this road, I slowly understand, oh, there is something called inorganic chemistry and physical chemistry. Organic chemistry is one of it. So I'll go to the next level. Now I see organic chemistry as chemistry now. If I go even further, I will see it as basic elements. The Grigor Mendeleev's table, I will, oh, it is nothing but hydrogen and nitrogen and phosphorus. What is organic chemistry? It is hydrocarbon. Carbon and hydrogen, that's all. My understanding becomes like that. I will still see benzene, but now I will see hydrocarbon there. In the benzene ring, I will see C6H6 and all that. O12, everything I will see. So I will go to basic elements. If I am even deep into it, I will know that, oh, all these elements are nothing but made of proton, electron, and neutron. Whether it is oxygen, hydrogen, platinum, or, you know, rare metals, or iron, or phosphorus, or whatever, they are all nothing but protons, electrons, and neutrons. It is only the number which is changing. That's another way to understand this existence. Or you can go even further. You can say, no, they are not even protons, electrons, and neutrons. They are all energy fields and effects. I don't know, what is this journey? Where will it take you? So it all depends on how do you see it. If you see a cockroach as a cockroach, you end there. That's the end of your life. If you are, that's like saying methane and benzene is all that world is all about, world of chemistry is all about. That means we have not progressed. That's what it means. Whereas on the other hand, if you were able to go further, then it is something else. It is something even more interesting. So look at here, for example. Why this is not moving? It's something happening. Are you able to see?
Yes, sir. We are able to see, sir.
Okay. Now it is moving. Suddenly my, you know, mouse became inactive. I don't know why. Anyway, let us look at the equivalent example. You can see yourself as, you know, father, mother, brother, sister. You can go to that level. or you can rise a little bit and say Indian, American, Chinese, dot, 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 dot. You can go one more level. You can say human beings, plants, animals. You can go even further. You can say living beings, non-living beings, and things like that. If you go even further, you can go to what is called Prajapati. That's what these Puranas and all, if you read, how the, you know, Daksha Prajapati, he had 63 daughters, how he married 8 of the daughters to Kashyapa Prajapati, how this world was created. I mean, they're telling in a very figurative way, but if you leave all those names, you will see, oh, this is how they, you know, one out of the 8 wives of Kashyapa Prajapati, one wife created the plant kingdom. Another wife created the animal kingdom. Manu, one wife called Manu, created human beings. That's why we are called Manavas. She created the human beings. Like that, it is explained. So leave all those figurative stories. You will see there is a logic of how this origin happened. So you can look at Praja. You can look at the world as embodiment of nothing but the offsprings of Prajapati. Or you can go that even Prajapati is made of Purusha and Prakriti. That's a primordial force of creation. All these are discussed, na, by the way. Or you can go to Brahman, the Nirguna Brahman. Satapo tapyata, satapas taptva idagum sarvam asrijata. So divinity, you have to decide where you want to see. You can see wherever you want to see.